I love you.
We have to be very quiet on this one. I just put the potatoes. I put them in the fryer. They're sleeping. So we got to be real quiet. Okay?
All right. But only for like half a minute, right?
Yeah, I'm not going to care after a while. Yeah.
Well, no, I'm just saying like, you know, it only takes so long to cook potatoes.
Yeah, I mean, they could sit in there for a while. It's a nice steamy bath.
Yeah.
I should probably remove them, shouldn't I?
Yeah, yeah. That's how you start fires.
All right. I'll take them out of there. They're nice and golden brown.
All right. Well, we'll munch on these potatoes while we talk to these potatoes. Oh, I thought this was the Secret Potato Podcast. This is our podcast, isn't it? Oops.
Yeah, we have a secret podcast where we just sit on the couch, like surrounded by potatoes, and just talk to them.
Yeah, just talk to them, and you know, eat a couple, and
tell them bedtime stories before we like torture a few of them.
We're sick, man.
Have you ever seen Sausage Party, the Seth Rogen animated, where they like cut up the potato and they're like cutting his eyes off? And he's like, oh God,
God, my eyes. Why are the gods doing this to us?
We're not talking that silly movie today. We're talking a different animation.
Yeah.
I am the Green Traveler.
And I am the Faceless Leon. This is a podcast about movies and TV.
Someday we'll make a movie about podcasts.
And sometime we will. We'll put that down on our plan bill.
That'll be our popular, our proper evolution.
yeah. Like Pokemon. First you make a movie, then you make a podcast, then you make a movie about podcasting.
Yeah, today we're talking Sleeping Beauty, hence the ridiculous and stupid intro I decided to come up with.
Yeah.
Sleeping Beauty, this comes, this is kind of crazy. It comes 4 years after the last film, Lady and the Tramp, it's only crazy because now Disney puts out like 8 movies a year, and so it's hard to imagine that they took so long of a gap between their animations. But I guess they even do that today, because like the last one, what was the last one? Was it Frozen 2?
Well, I think 2 years ago. Raya and the Last Dragon was the last one that's considered.
Oh, that's right.
It was Frozen 2, and then it was Moana before that.
Yeah, and it seemed like I mean, it might have been back-to-back years, but it seemed like there was a gap between Moana and Frozen 2.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure there was quite a gap. And it seemed like there was a decent gap between Frozen, the original one, and Moana. Because we started working at Target towards the tail end of the toy phenomenon of Frozen.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and then it seemed like we were okay for a little bit, and then there was that fucking singing chicken that just never quit from Moana.
Yep, I remember that.
Like the chicken's like my least remembered part of that movie.
Yeah,
but I remember it's the true. Chicken.
Yeah,
because that song fucking sucked.
God, I can't. I really don't want to get to the Frozen days in this playlist, but we'll get there.
We'll get there. We'll be 82.
I'm not looking forward to it, man. I don't hate the new stuff, but it's just
I don't even hate Frozen, but like the hype was so big on it, and when we went to go see it, I was like, okay, like it was okay, and everybody was like, what? And I was like, no, it was just okay. And then the hype just continued, and you just hear it everywhere. And it was like, all right, I am sick of this. This is done. This is dead to me.
I didn't even go to the theaters. Like, you guys recommended it, and I was just like, I think I pirated it on my laptop and just watched it there.
Aren't we trying to get paid by Disney?
That's what I was gonna say. It was totally a joke, Disney. Like, I still want sponsorship. I'll still shell out to them. I totally rented this off of some renting site. I am 100% certain.
Yes, I'm certain that I watched him. I am witness.
Exactly, and I remember watching it, And Ken was just like, you're going to really like it. You're going to like it. And he was sitting over in on his side of the room. And then I finished it, closed my laptop, and he's like, you didn't like it, did you? And I was like, eh, it's all right.
Yeah, I'm totally with you. It was just okay. It was hyped up so much that I was disappointed in it. Like, if I had no hype in it and I had went to see it, I would have been happy with it.
I remember Frozen when it came out, like, every single toy in Target, everything. Like, you jostle a box and you hear Let It Go. It was so damned frustrating. And, like, it is a good song. That's the problem, is that it's a very good song. But it's so annoying when it's played over and over again. Like, that was the worst part about Frozen. And why I like Raya and the Last Dragon so much is because I don't work at a retail store. And yeah. I'm not constantly harassed by the latest toys and shit. So it's like, I could just watch Raya and the Last Dragon and be like, that was amazing. I'm going to set it aside and, you know, put it on the shelf until I'm ready to watch it again. Whereas with Frozen and Moana, it was just constantly bashing me in the face everywhere I went. And it's just like, fuck these movies.
For sure. Anyhow, excuse me. Sleeping Beauty. I did not intend that to happen, but it worked and I should just went with it. Anyhow, this story, like, you know, other Disney stories, is an old story. So what I like to do is talk a little bit about the origins of these old stories that Disney's adapting. I will say this one is not nearly as old, at least considered to be nearly as old as Cinderella. It is believed that it was probably started around the 1300s. Then eventually that version of the tale was published by Basile, or Basile, I can't remember, Italian guy. Same guy from we got the three same authors in Europe that printed different versions of this stories again. Giambattista Basile in Italian, and then in French we had Perrault, and then the Brothers Grimm in German. And I mentioned last time that Cinderella is considered type like 5'10 or something. This is type 4'10, which means there's a magical...
Which means the Snow White.
Yeah. Yeah, I think honestly Snow White in this story is pretty much the same story, where the princess falls asleep and the magic is reversed at the end.
Right. Here's something that, like, really pisses me off. Is so, as is becoming the norm with the Silver Age that I'm discovering, is I haven't really watched Sleeping Beauty more than once, which is a little surprising. But when I was rewatching, I was like, I don't remember any of this. I only remember Maleficent. Those are the only things I remember, because that was all that interested me as a kid. Because honestly, as we get into this movie, and as you'll hear from me a lot probably in the next 20 minutes, this movie's fucking boring as shit.
Yeah, it's a little boring.
Unless Maleficent's on the screen. Yeah. But what really makes me mad is I've had many conversations with many, many Disney fans where I will accidentally mix up Snow White and Sleeping Beauty. And they just kind of make fun of me. It's just like, come on, man. That's totally Sleeping Beauty. What's wrong with you, you idiot? And I'm just like, what? You know, and I never understood why I just morphed them. And like, both of those stories are just morphed for me. When I think Snow White, sometimes I think Snow White versus Maleficent. Like, it just seems like she should be the villain. Like, there should be a dragon in that movie. And so, you know, a lot of Disney people have made fun of me. And then I watched this movie again, and I realized it literally is just Snow White, and they can go fuck themselves.
Yeah.
For me thinking that they're the exact same movie, because they are the exact same movie.
It's the same plot with a different skin on it. I'm totally with you. I'm 100% with you. So,
pisses me off that they made fun of me.
Well, you know, they're just hardcore, and they know all the frames. That's the problem. They know all the frames and where they go. They've had all the puzzles growing up. And in Snow White, she has at least 20 times more agency than Sleeping Beauty. Sleeping Beauty is literally accursed by a prophecy, and she just follows the steps through the prophecy. That's the story. Right. She she's not a very good protagonist. And in fact, some people refer to her as the least feminist Disney princess. Because she literally, this story just happens to her. And I guess, would you like to synopsize it?
Yeah, sure. I don't remember why. I think it might just be because Sleeping Beauty was born. What's her real name? Aurora?
Aurora is the princess's name, yes.
Is Rose like her last name, or am I just making
that up? No, when she later goes to live with the fairies, her name is Primrose.
Oh, okay, gotcha. There we go. Yeah. I think she's like just born, or maybe the party is like for her, like signifying who she's gonna marry or whatever. I can't remember, but there's a big party, and Maleficent's not invited, and that pisses her off. So she curses the baby, of course, like you do.
Yeah.
Like, I thought that was hilarious. Like, if I don't get invited to a party, I just like become passive aggressive. It's like, oh yeah, that would have been fun. Yeah, sure, I would have. Yeah, totally. Yeah, I wasn't doing anything yesterday. Yeah, but like, no, Maleficent's immediately like, I'm cursing you for all life. Like, you're gonna grow up, you're gonna hit 16, you're gonna prick your finger on some kind of spindly thing, and you're just gonna die. And it's like, well, shit, that's kind of cruel, but all right, next time we'll invite you to the fucking party, I guess.
Yeah, like, geez, God.
This is what, the 1400s? Everybody has more kids. Like, come on, okay. But yeah, because of that, because she is cursed, the fairies each had one gift to give, and I think two of them had already given theirs,
yes.
and the third was about to give hers, and she's like, well, I can't undo the curse, but I can, you know, add a caveat.
Yep.
And so she adds a little caveat that Sleeping Beauty won't die. She'll just be put to sleep, and true love's kiss can wake her up. Sure. All right. Sure. Yeah, that makes sense, I guess. That's beautiful little tale, as long as you've met the man before and you know that it is true love, and that it's not just this weird little
yeah.
I met you once upon a dream, and that's it.
Hey, though, at the very least, they do meet each other. I was going to say that, because growing up, I do not remember that part where they actually meet each other and dance.
Right.
Or at the very least, like, the once upon a dream shit made me think that it was a dream.
But I do like that song, the once upon a dream song.
It's a good song.
They do. The fairies ferry her away and mm-hmm. hide her away from Maleficent's view, and she lives a normal life up until the point when she's 16 and shit happens. She meets Prince Philip. Is it Philip?
That's right. It's Prince Philip.
Hey, look at this memory on me.
This prince and, has a name.
Literally, my notes are just Maleficent. I wrote, Maleficent's grand appearance as it finally arrives at minute 7:45. And like, that's all that it is like notes about Maleficent, because when she's not on screen, I'm bored as fucking all get
out. Well, okay, but I did find Flora, Fauna, and Merryweather, the good fairies, I found them all to be rather enjoyable characters, and they have their own little spats between them, especially Flora and Merryweather.
Yeah.
Like, they want things to either be pink or blue, respectively. And then Fauna tries to bake a cake.
Yeah, that stuff's a lot of fun, but there's only like one scene of that.
Right.
And then the rest of it is just kind of like background bickering.
Yeah, they could have done something more with it. But I think they tried to do something more with it in Maleficent, and it didn't help.
I don't remember it.
Yeah, exactly. What I wanted to mention, Flora and Fauna are voiced by Verna Felton and Barbara Jo Allen, and they do fine jobs. Felton also plays Queen Leah. But anyhow, what I want to talk about is Merryweather is the return of Lady Barbara Luddy. That voice is just so good. And she does, it's like, she is the, I don't know if shorter tempered is the correct term for the fairy, but she gets bothered easier than Flora and Fauna do, at least by Flora and Fauna's actions. And I think that her voice lends well to this comical thing. And also, it's very lullabaic when she adds on to the curse to save the baby. She's the one who gets that wish. About the fairies, going back to origin stories, the fairies show up in Perrault's version of the story, and there's actually 7 good fairies that are invited.
Ah, 7 dwarves.
Yes. And but they didn't invite this old fairy who was living as a hermit in a tower, and everybody thought was just dead. They didn't invite her, and so she felt bad about that, and she cursed her to do the spindle thing. This is also where the spindle's introduced. Neither of these things were in Basile's version of the story. In fact, there was a flax seed that got stuck in Princess... She's not even a princess. She's a daughter of a lord. Talia is her name. And she gets a flax seed stuck under her finger. And then a king comes by the abandoned house and finds her asleep and has sex with her. Oh, yes. Okay. And then she gets pregnant and has twins named Sun and Moon. And then, while sleeping, yes, and one of the children sucks at her finger and draws out the flax seed, and she wakes up and finds out that she's a mother. Eventually, this king guy comes back, and he's like, oh, you're awake. This is what happened. And then they fall in love, but he's like, hey, I'll come back for you and bring you back to the kingdom soon. And he goes back, and... his wife, the queen, finds out about it and sends a letter pretending to be the king to Talia, asking her to send the children. And so she has the children sent, and she's like, hey, I want you to cook these children for the king. Cook is like, I'm not going to do that. And eventually the king finds out about it, and he burns the queen to death. Then he and Talia get married.
You know, make a few changes, but spruce that up. And I really like that story a lot more than what we got.
Yeah, you think so? That him sleeping with the dead woman?
I said make a few changes, spruce it up a little, and we got a good story there.
Well, that's what Perrault tried to do. So Perrault, okay, but Perrault had the fairies. Perrault brings in the fairies and the spindle and the curse and the prophecy, right? And then I think that part is still fun.
I think Child Cake would have been a little entertaining.
Yes, okay, that would have been.
I'm saying she should have cooked them a little, you know, that should have been like part of her endgame.
Well, she was part dragon, so she could have done that. But anyhow, in Perrault's version... there is that trope of the story, but it's actually the princess's mother-in-law. So the prince finds her and is like, oh, she's sleeping. She's magnificent. And he kisses her. That's it. Just kisses her. Nothing super gross. And it wakes her up. This is also after 100 years have passed. So she's been sitting there sleeping for 100 years. And so is the rest of the kingdom. So, yeah, it's a little gross, but she's so beautiful that he has to kiss her. And she wakes up, and so does everybody else in the castle. And then he brings her home, and he becomes king, but his queen mother is part ogre, apparently. And she tries to have the cook cook the children, and then tries to have the cook cook the wife. But both times, the cook's like, I'm not going to do that. And eventually they kick the ogress out, I guess. No, this is it. She fills a cauldron full of vipers or something like that and jumps into it, and then she's gone.
She's still digging that. Like, why can't we have Maleficent as a villain and also that as a villain? Let's have some trials for Sleeping Beauty.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the Brothers Grimm, they disagreed with you. They said, that's two different stories. That's two different stories. So their Sleeping Beauty ends after the prince kisses the Sleeping Beauty, which kind of is about what happens in the Disney version, to be honest. Not much happens after that. There is a dragon fight, and like you said, Maleficent's the coolest part, so it's pretty cool. But then there's the evil mother-in-law, which is the other story that they took from Perrault
and made into Cinderella. Yeah.
No, it's different. Because the mother-in-law, they're already married, so it's not the stepmother. It's not the evil stepmother.
Oh, okay.
It's the evil mother-in-law.
Gotcha. Huh.
Similar but different.
And yet, in the end, it's just Snow White and not a better version of Snow White.
That's true. You got anything else to say about the actual movie?
No. I guess it was one of the first. It was another version of widescreen CinemaScope. I just can't remember what it was called, but it was another first for animation where it's like, this is the first one using like CinemaScope widescreen, or I don't remember what it was. But, you know, again, changing up the animation scheme, still perfecting their stuff. Like, it still looks good. I really loved how it looked. And
yeah,
that, you know, Once Upon a Dream song is still, I like that, even though I, you know,
it's definitely stuck in your head. You were singing it right before we started. Yeah.
And singing it poorly.
Well, I don't know. It wasn't that bad.
Hey, thanks, man.
You're welcome. About this movie, I had something and it's gone. Well, there are some cool things. Oh, it was about the animation. I do remember watching a documentary. Could not tell you when I watched the documentary, but it was about somebody who worked with Disney. And he said, after making this movie, that he would never make another animated movie the same way. Because, like, I guess, like, they painstakingly, like, painted each cell or instead of copying it or something like that.
Shit.
Yeah. Or I can't remember exactly, so don't quote me on this. You shouldn't quote me on any other thing that I say on this show.
Never quote me. We're not podcasters.
Okay, you can quote me. Just remember that it might not be true.
Ooh. You can quote me on that if you go to our Patreon at patreon.com/greenandfaceless.
That's right.
And subscribe to our Patreon page. You can get votes on our threesomes later on.
That's right. That's true indeed.
Among other things.
I'm not sure. I don't remember what date this episode's going to come out. But yeah, we might be voting currently. We might be looking for suggestions still. So, you know, if you're willing to give us your pinched pennies, we're liable to pinch you back, potatoes.
Oh, my.
Oh, did you get those out of the fryer?
Nah, I think it's on fire, actually. I might have left them in. I think we removed them at the beginning, actually. I just don't remember if I put them right back in.
Yeah. I ate them all already.
But with Sleeping Beauty, closing statements with it, really fucking bored. The only notes I took down were Maleficent notes. When Maleficent entered, you know, she's very intimidating. She's a really good villain. She's so cold. She's so just fucking brutal at times. And she becomes a fucking dragon at the end. Like, it's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
But she's the only thing about this whole movie that I care about. Like, the fairies are fun.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's some funny moments. I remember the kings fighting over, like, fighting with fish. Like,
yes.
One of them has a fish as a sword. There's a ladder as a shield.
Heavy drinking scene between both the kings and one of their, like, tasters or something. And all three of them are super drunk.
Yeah, that's right.
And then he says something along the lines of, like, what if she doesn't want to get married to Philip? And Philip's dad's like, what's wrong with my Philip? And he goes to draw his sword, but he grabs a fish instead.
That shit's funny. I remember, I laugh, but at the same time, I kind of forget it. Like, you mentioning all of that, it was coming back as you were saying it. I was like, all right, that is exactly what happened. I was remembering it as you were talking about it. But all I remembered prior was some guy was swinging a fish and I was laughing at it. Like, it's boring. It goes away immediately. Like, there's no engagement other than Maleficent as the villain. Everything just feels like a complete ripoff of Snow White. You know, the fairies are the dwarves. And the evil witch is Maleficent. Like, I tell you, when I watch Snow White, I expect the evil witch to turn into a dragon, but she turns into an evil witch. I'm like, oh, right.
Oh, that's right.
That's Sleeping Beauty.
Though, honestly, her transformation scene, I think, is more impactful. I remember.
Yeah, it's disturbing.
Yeah, it's disturbing as fuck. So, did you give it a rating? I'm sorry. Okay.
I give it 2 stars. It's still a good movie.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a good animation. It's not awful. It's like you don't go below 2 stars unless you're really bad.
Right.
But this isn't really bad. It's still good, but it's not my favorite of the Silver Age. So
I'll give it that. I'm gonna give it a full face because it's a competent movie. Except for I wish the protagonist had more agency. But there's nothing wrong with, hey, the story of there's this prophecy and, oh, damn it, it came true, but in the end, everything's okay. There's nothing wrong with that story. However, the fact that they all kind of, I never got why the one fairy was like, we're going to put them all to sleep. It's so that they don't get disappointed. Yeah. In this story, it's so that they don't get disappointed when they come to her room and she's, passed out, nearly dead, because they're trying to marry her off. That's another thing about this movie. They're trying to marry her off so that she will have that kiss, so that the curse is null and void. But that doesn't happen. I think that it would have been more interesting if, like Maleficent said, Philip was in a cell for 100 years, and then finally the fairies found out where he was, released him, used their magic to restore his youth. And then he goes and saves her. I think that would have been more interesting.
Right.
And a better reason for them to be put, the whole kingdom to be put asleep. Because they put the whole kingdom to sleep, but they're only asleep for like half a day. So, like, I don't know. It just seems like you might as well go with the more traditional telling of 100 years if you're going to do that.
Yeah, I honestly forgot that they had put them to sleep. Like, most of the time. it's not awesome
important to the story.
Yeah, I mean, but the only thing I remember of dragon of the ending is dragon fight and a kiss. Like that's it. Yeah. That's all I got at the ending.
Yeah,
is he kisses her.
That's all you need.
And then there's also a dragon fight.
So yeah, I guess I feel like all in all, not necessarily recommending this one, but it's not like you have to avoid this one if you're going through a movie marathon.
It didn't have a racist placard at the front, and we got to.
It didn't. For that. It didn't. However, it should have a sexist one.
That's the truth.
Oh, well, I think that's our show.
Hell yeah. I've been the Green Traveler, everybody.
And I have been the Faceless Leon. Safe travels and good night. Green and Faceless on the Couch is a proud production of Fiction Works 19. If you like the show, please show your support by rating and reviewing us on Apple Podcasts. Like, follow, subscribe, wherever you might listen. We also now have a Patreon account. If you feel so inclined to support us in a financial manner, please become a patron by visiting patreon.com/greenandfaceless. You can also find more information about us on our Facebook account or on the FictionWorks 19 Instagram account. Thank you so much for listening.